Hallelujah. This is the day the Lord has made. I'm sorry, what did you say? And we will what? Rejoice and be glad in it. Why? Because you got a choice, Martin. Everyone, turn to your neighbor, you got a choice. Rejoice or get out of here. Nothing worse than a miserable Christian, amen? They need to stay home in the closet until they get filled. Don't tell nobody when you're miserable that you know Jesus. Amen? Because my Jesus ain't miserable. Amen. Praise be to God. Oh, glory. There's a lot of things going on, isn't there? Amen. Things are shifting. We got a holy shift going on. Amen. I mean, it's powerful what's going on. I love it. Yesterday, the president's wife got, they had a meeting, right? And she gets up and she goes, "Let us pray." Whoa, I almost fell out of my seat. "Let us pray." Yes! And she did the Our Father, which was good. I mean, we haven't heard "let us pray" before a meeting started, and sheesh. That's been a long time. Why? Because there's a shift going on. Tremendous shift. And I'm going to talk Tuesday night why the shift is going on because of 2017. But I ain't going to talk about it today. You want to hear it? You got to come Tuesday. Hallelujah! John chapter 14. Let's grow for it. Oh, yes. I want to welcome everyone here today. Those of you, you are new, if we lock the door, don't be afraid. Hallelujah. No, we won't lock the door on you. Praise God. Well, the word says make no place for the devil, right? Amen. So you got to lock the devil out. Amen. John 14 and verse 1, let's speak it. Because what you speak is what you eat, and what you eat is what you become. Yes. So if we speak light and life, you know what? You become light and life. And we want to shake off these demons that keep trying to attach themselves to us. In verse 1, would you read it with me? "Let not your heart be what? Troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said, of course, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. And how can we know the way?" Jesus was very gentle with him. Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except for through me." This is so powerful. Jesus, I want you to grab hold of something. He was setting up an order. He was setting up a divine order now. In fact, when he said, "I am the way, truth, and life," he was representation that he was the tabernacle, which is called the eternal port. That's why it's the way. You enter through the way. The next chamber is the truth. The next chamber is life. You enter through this eternal port that God Almighty is the only one that can create, and it's the only way you can go through to get home. You can't go around it, go under it, or go over it. Many people are trying to get up all kinds of ways, but you can't. Only through the eternal port are you have access to eternal life. And before you can access that, you must have a DNA change. There must be an eternal DNA. Everybody with me? So there is a specific order that God is setting up. That's what he came to do, is set up order. There's a divine order. Amen? That's why when you go to court, you ever hear him say, "Order in the court!" Right? What are they trying to do? Get everybody's attention to get things in order. And that's what God is doing right now. There is order in the court big time. He's getting people in order. Why? Because something phenomenal is about to happen. Luke 9. Luke chapter 9. In verse 23, Luke 9:23, hallelujah. Would you read it with me? Then Jesus said to a couple, very good. He said to them, what? All. He said, yo, homie. If anyone desires to come after me, in other words, you want to get in my eternal port that I'm setting up, that means you must come after me. So he's going to place something in order to maintain position in this place and to continue to go in. He said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me, let him what? Deny himself. In other words, keep distant from the old man. Because the old man's offspring of darkness. And take up his cross. And of course, if you pull the cross out of a ground, what does it turn into? A sword. It means you got to fight to follow. No fight, you can't follow. So he says, deny yourself, take up the cross, fight. When?
Daily.
Daily. Every day. I only do it when I go to church. Well, then you're deceived. Does everybody get it? He said, every day. Then you can what? Follow. Again, if you can't deny yourself, he's setting something in order, isn't he? This is a place of order. He's setting things up. Order in the court. Let's go. Come on. Everybody's tighten up. Let's get going. I got work to do. And time's running out. He's saying, setting up order. In other words, deny yourself. Deny your life and give me it. Deny your desires and give me it. Deny your will and give me it. Deny everything in this world and untangle yourself. Get disconnected from this world so you can get connected with me, he says. Because if you're still connected with the world, you can't get connected with me. You got to cut loose of everything. Amen? And so he says this. He said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and then you can follow. For whoever desires to save his life will what? Lose it. And whoever loses his life for my sake will what? Save it. For what profit is a man if he gains the whole world and he himself is destroyed or lost? Again, this is a divine order. God is saying, listen, I'm putting things back in order. That's why he put his presence in the White House. He's putting things in order because the Antichrist presence has been ruling for too long. Things are changing. You're going to see a lot of turmoil. You're going to see a lot of shaking. You're going to see a lot of rebellion. You're going to see a lot of protesting. Look, the only thing they're protesting is the will of God because they don't know it. You're going to see all kinds of things happening. So he's saying, deny, surrender. Pick up that cross, pick up the sword and follow me to access the eternal port home. This is the divine order or the courts of the Lord, and he's requiring order in the court. It is a place or position of exchange. It's a place or position of what? Exchange. Exodus 39. Again, I want to share with you that everything revolves around the tabernacle of God. That's why Jesus came. He was the eternal tabernacle. Exodus 39. You know, there's a reason why it's called Exodus. Exit, stage left. Some of you don't know that. For those of us that do. Anyways, it's just exit means exit, amen? There's an exit door, you know? Get out. Exit. Exodus 39:32. Glory. It says something powerful because the Lord required them to build a tabernacle. Why was God building a tabernacle here on the earth? For him to meet with them. Amen? Exodus 39:32. Let's read it together. Thus all the work of the tabernacle, the tent of meeting, was finished, and the children of Israel did according to all that the Lord had commanded Moses, so they did. And they brought the tabernacle to Moses, the tent and all its furnishings, and its clasps, its boards, its bars, its pillars, and its sockets, the covering of the ram skins dyed red, the covering of the badger skins, and the veil of the covering, the ark of the testimony with its poles and its mercy seat, the table and all its utensils and the showbread, the pure gold lampstand with its lamps, the lamps set in what? Order. In other words, they were provided. God was getting all of this to put everything in order. Does everybody get it? And its utensils and the oil for the light, the gold altar, the anointing oil, and the sweet incense, the screen for the tabernacle door, the bronze altar, its grate of bronze, its poles and all its utensils, and the laver with its base, the hangings of the court, its pillars and all its sockets, the screen for the court gate, its cords and its pegs, all the utensils for the service of the tabernacle, for the tent of what? Meeting. And the garments of the ministry to minister in the holy place, the holy garments for Aaron, the priest, and his sons, garments to minister as priests, according to all that the Lord had what? Commanded Moses, so the children of Israel did all the work. In other words, God was placing in order his tabernacle, the place of meeting. Is everybody with me? Now go to Exodus 40 and verse 1. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, on the first day of the first month, you shall set up the tabernacle of the tent of meeting. You shall put in it the ark of the testimony, the partition off the ark with a veil. He's setting up the chambers. You shall bring in the table and arrange. And a what? Arrange. Does that mean put in order? Yes. The things that are to be set in order on it. And you shall bring the lampstand and the lights and its lamps. You shall also set the altar of gold for the incense before the ark of the testimony, and put up the screen for the door of the tabernacle. Then you shall set the altar of the burnt offering before the door of the tabernacle, the tent of meeting. You shall set the laver between the tabernacle of meeting and the altar, and put water in it. Now what he's doing, he's separating. There are three chambers that he's separating. That's why Jesus said, I am the way, which is the outer court. I am the truth, which is the holy place. And I am the life, which means the most holy place. And that is still in existence now. Everything revolves around the tabernacle. And there's no way home except for going through it. You shall set up the court all around and hang up the screen at the court gate. And you shall take the what? Anointing oil. And anoint the tabernacle and all that is in it. You shall hallow it and all its utensils. And it shall be what? Holy. So understand that now there's the anointing that's coming about. In other words, now he's setting things in oil with the anointing. Does everybody get it? Everything is being set in order with the anointing. Oh. See, sir, there's a special order that God has set. And in this order, with the anointing, he's able to get us in a place or position where everything is exchanged. Sickness is exchanged for healing. Bondages is exchanged for freedom. Death is exchanged for life. See, but we must continue to battle through to get into that order. Remember, he said, deny yourself. Hello. Pick up the sword and fight and follow. Why? That's an order. That's an order of battle. That's a divine order. Again, why? So he can position me and you for a place of exchange. There's two things that will prevent you from doing there. The first one is pride. And the second one is fear. Those are two enemies that prevent order. Amen? What's the two enemies that prevent order? Pride and fear. Psalm 100. Hallelujah. Make a what? A joyful shout to the Lord. All you lands. What does it say? Serve the Lord with gladness. Did you ever see anybody serve the Lord miserable? Well, if they are, they ain't my Lord. Come before his presence with what? Singing. What's he doing? He's setting up an order, isn't he? Singing. Know that the Lord, he is good. He's God, and he's good too. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves, so we can stop that I God stuff. Amen? He made us. He's the one that gave us the talents. He's the one that gave us the abilities. Amen. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. All right, are you ready? Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his what? Courts with praise. Why? Because you praise and worship? What are you doing? You're denying you. That's why he says, come after me with all of your heart. Be thankful to him and bless his name. The Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Enter his courts and gates. Psalm 84. This is a divine order, isn't it? Why? Because it's known as a play. He's trying to get us to a place of what? Exchange. Place of what? Exchange. See, so many people don't reach that place. See, the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. The first thing he wants to steal is your identity, who you are. If he can get you to steal your identity, you pick up another one. He wants to exchange your identity for something other world. That's the first thing he comes after, your identity. When he can get, when he starts messing with your identity, he begins to disconnect you from God and reconnect you back to the world. That's why every day you and I have a process of disconnect. We just did a teaching on it. Disconnect from what? Disconnect from the world so you can stay connected to him. Listen, these things bring self-deliverance. In Psalm 84, how lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. See, you should be joyful to come together in corporate to worship God while you're pressing in. You're pressing in. Has everybody got it? See, some people tolerate it because they're disconnected. If you're tolerating it, you're disconnected. But when you're connected, you love it. You look forward to it. You love to get in God's presence. Why? Because that's a place of exchange. Amen. You don't let anything interfere with you getting into God's presence. No job, no money, no nothing. You get into God's presence because that's your life. Verse 3. Even the sparrow has found a home and the swallow a net for himself where she may lay her young. Even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be what? Praising you. Let's keep going. I like this one. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a spring. The rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. Hallelujah. Listen, you don't wait, have to wait to appear before him. You be appear before him every single day. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. My O God, behold our shield and look upon the face of your anointed. Verse 10. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. Psalm 92. Verse 13. This is order in the court. It says, those who are what? planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. In other words, they shall prosper. They shall learn more. More revelation comes. More visitation comes. More things begin to happen to you because you're dwelling in God's presence. They shall still be what? Verse 14. Okay, those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. 14. They shall still bear fruit in old age. They still, they'll be what? Fresh and flourishing. Praise God. You can stay 33 all the way till you go home. To what? To declare that the Lord is upright. He is my rock and there is no unrighteousness in him. Psalm 96. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Give to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him all the earth. The offering that you're bringing is called the sacrifice of praise. Amen? It is called the sacrifice of praise. In verse Psalm 24, there's order in God's tabernacle. There's order in the court. Why is there order? Because he's trying to get us to a place of what? Exchange. Psalm 24. Everybody there? Glory. Verse 3, it says what? Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord, and who may stand in his holy place or his tabernacle? He who has what? Clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to an idol, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is Jacob, the generation of those who what? Seek him and who what? Seek his face. See, you know, look, there are things that you can't do by yourself. Amen? There's just things you can't do. But there's certain things you can't get broke off of by yourself. You have to get in God's presence to get things broken off. Why? Because it is the place that God has established. He's ordained it. He's the one that set it up. He said, here's a place of exchange. Amen? It is called a place of exchange. The Word of God should always put a desire in you to reach that place of exchange. That's why the word says, forsake not to assemble. Why? Because it's a place of exchange. Oh, hallelujah. Psalm 37. You know, I mean, think about how many times the enemy attacks you when it's time to gather together. You got a flat tire, you know. Don't feel good. And I'm not saying that there's sometimes you're dying. Praise God, it's a good day to die though, ain't it? I mean, you ain't to worry about dying, you're going home, right? If you're right with God, only those who fear death ain't right with God. Amen. Psalm 37, is everybody there? In verse 32. Okay, let's do 23 first. Psalm 37, verse 23. Is everybody there? Come on, let's speak it. The steps of a good man are what? Ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. Listen, counsel, correction, and direction bring order. Everybody thinks, so when God orders me and you to do something, it's to what? Put us in order. To get us to a place of exchange. In fact, he ordered 500 disciples before he left and went home. He said, listen, I want all of you. I command you. That's an order. Amen. How many of you know when God speaks, it's an order? It's also called a command. He said, look, I want you all to hang out. Go to the upper room. If you got to order pizza, I don't care. But wait 10 days. Because after 10 days, I'm going to come and I'm going to come in another form. and I'm going to make you my tabernacle. And I'm going to come and dwell in you. And I'm going to exchange your old for new. I'm going to give you a new spirit. I'm going to give you a new heart. And I'm going to give you my spirit. And in this, it's going to cause you. It's going to bring you conviction. It's going to bring you counsel, correction, direction. It's going to guide you to all truth. And it's going to tell you things to come. It will give you new eyes and new ears. You'll see things differently. You'll hear things differently. And there's something else I'm going to place in you. Reverence, honor, and respect. Amen. Called the fear of the Lord. This is what I'm going to do with you, he said. And you know what? Only 120 of them obeyed. Like I tell everybody else, the rest of them went and started denominations. Hallelujah. So what does God do? He places things in orders. Everybody got it? His commands are orders. Why are they given? To keep us in order. Amen? Why? So we reach the place of position to exchange. Psalm 50. Oh, glory. Verse 21. Hallelujah. Let's speak it. These things you have done and I kept silent. You thought that I was altogether like you, but I will rebuke you and set them in what? Order before your eyes. Now consider this, you who forgot God, lest I tear you in pieces, and there be none to deliver. Whoever offers what? Praise offers, glorifies me. And to him who orders his conduct what? Aright, I will show the salvation of God. So there's an area where he's saying, look, when you walk in order, you're gonna make it home. You get out of order, you got trouble. He's setting things in order right now. Big time. That's why you're seeing it happen in the government. You're seeing it all over the world. It's a ripple effect that God is doing all over the world. Why? End time, last time harvest. We're the return. We're the generation and return of the Lord. And Titus. This letter goes out in verse 5, and he said, for this reason I left you in Crete, that you should set in order the things that are what? Lacking, and appoint elders in every city as I command you. If a man is blameless, a husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of dissipation or insubordination. Amen. For a bishop or someone that's in charge must be blameless as a steward of God, not what? Self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to booze, not violent, booze or drugs, hello, not violent, not greedy for money, but hospitable, a lover of what is good, sober-minded, just, holy, and self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and convict those who are contradict. Contradict. Why is he saying? Because look at the next. He said, because there's many insubordinate, both idle talkers, deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole households, teaching things which they ought not, for the sake of dishonest gain. So these are happening right now. Look at, there's a lot of infiltration going on. There's a lot of stealth of the enemy. Hidden, causing division and bringing lust and perversion, bringing greed, all kinds of things. You and I must maintain things in order so we can constantly make that, stay in that position and reach that position of exchange. Look at, everybody goes through something, but there's a phenomenal word that I just said, through. You go through it. You don't get stuck there. If you get stuck there, it's because you're not in God's presence enough. Amen? Or you're not sowing your way out, speaking your way out. 1 Corinthians 15. Hallelujah. Place of exchange. Thought I'd give you the title. Because you probably got a bunch of them written down. I knew you were going to write that down. In fact, that was my first choice, but the Lord said, no, place of exchange. Okay, man. Order in a court. No, place of exchange. Without order in a court, you don't get to the place of exchange. Amen? Amen. 1 Corinthians 15, 22. And speak it. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made what? Alive. Is that an exchange? Yeah. You betcha. But each one in his own order, Christ the first fruits. Afterward, those who are Christ at his what? Coming. Then comes the what? And there's three orders, isn't it? When he delivers the kingdom of God to the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. How many of y'all want to put enemies under Jesus' feet? Amen. Well, that's our job. Everyone say, I'm called.
To battle.
My purpose is to destroy Satan's kingdom. And my destiny is to infiltrate the world system with talents and abilities to rescue those who have been taken captive. You got it? I got it. Praise God. Exodus 13. The word Egypt means house of bondage. How many of you know the world is ruled by Satan's kingdom? It's actually ruled by deception and fear. Because if people really knew the truth, they wouldn't be doing what they do they? We got a t-shirt called Who Told You That? You can go to the website. It's called whotoldyouthat.co. Whotoldyouthat.company. Who told you that? The purpose of that is so that people get a reality of what they're hearing. Who told you that? Anybody ever say something stupid to you and you want to say, what the heck? You need to say, who told you that, dummy? Who told you to be angry? Who told you to hate? Who told you to touch that? Who told you to lie? Who told you to use drugs? Who told you to drink? Does everybody get that? So, in fact, that's in the book of Genesis. Jesus said it to Adam. Who told you that? Who told you that you were naked? Who told you that you were afraid? Did you partake of that thing? I told you not to. See, people are not monitoring their thoughts. Can you imagine if the whole world monitored their thoughts? We'd be more in one accord, wouldn't we? You wouldn't have these idiots chopping heads off. Who told you that? Those are demon-possessed individuals. Amen? Who told you the hate? They promote hate. God is not hatred. He said hate evil, but don't hate people. Amen. Oh, glory. Exodus 13. Is everybody there? So God did what? He led the people around by way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel went up in what? Orderly rank out of the land of Egypt. How many of you all know this? You got to get in order to get out of here. Philippians 2. Philippians chapter 2. Philippians. Is everybody there? Philippians chapter 2. And I think it's in verse 12. Let's speak it. What does it say? Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with what? Fear and trembling. There's an order. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. And do all things without what? Complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, and that I have not run in vain or labored in vain. Proverbs chapter 1. Again, this place where God positions us, and the area where there's a place of exchange is also known as God's presence. Amen? In this, what's he trying? He's trying to keep an area where you and I maintain the reverence and honor and respect, which is called the fear of the Lord. When you lose that, I hope that we fall into the terror of the Lord before we fall into the separation from the Lord. But the fear of the Lord is vitally important because it keeps an area of contact. It's always connecting. In Proverbs chapter 1, in verse 7, what does it say? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. In Proverbs 8. We're going to fly through this. I want you to see what the fear of the Lord represents, because this is what you know whether you're connected or not. When you lose the fear of the Lord, you are disconnected. Verse 13. The fear of the Lord is to what? Hate evil, pride and arrogance and the evil way, and the perverse mouth I hate. Well, Proverbs 9. In verse 10, the fear of the Lord maintains position of exchange. Does everybody understand that? I'm going to say it again. The fear of the Lord maintains position of exchange. When that is lost, you've been disconnected. You're out of there. What did I say to go? 9:10? Proverbs 9, verse 10. Let's speak it. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Lord, of the Holy One, is what? Understanding. One of the things that occurs is when God gives you wisdom, it tells you what to do. Understanding tells you how to do it. Amen? In Proverbs 14, verse 26 and 27. Let's speak it. In the fear of the Lord, there is strong confidence, and his children will have a place of refuge. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life to turn one away from the snares of death. Again, the fear of the Lord maintains position of exchange. When that is broke, you know that you're out of position. Is everybody okay? 1 Peter chapter 4. Place of exchange. In verse 1. Is everybody okay? Amen. Are you blessed? Amen. You getting this? Amen. Verse 1. Let's speak it. Therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same mind, with the same thoughts. Amen? Arm yourself. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live for the rest of his time in the flesh for the lust of men, but for the will of God. For we have spent enough of our past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles when we walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. And regarding these things, they think it's strange that you don't run with them in the same flood of dissipation, speaking evil of you. They will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this reason, the gospel is preached also to those who are dead, that they might be judged according to the men in the flesh, but live according to God in the spirit. But the end of all things is at hand, therefore be what? Serious and watchful in your prayers. Proverbs 1. Proverbs 1. In verse 28, is everybody there? Glory. Let's speak it together. Then they will call on me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but they will not find me, because they hated knowledge, and they did not choose the fear of the Lord. They would have none of my counsel and despise my every rebuke. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their own way and be filled to the full with their own fantasies. For the turning away of the simple will slay them, and the complacency of fools will destroy them. But whoever listens to me will dwell safely and will be secure without the fear of evil. Wow. So there's that area. You know, the fear of the Lord is your meter. That lets you know where you're at. When you lose that, you know you're disconnected. Remember, there's a divine order. There's an order in the court. There's a place that God is setting things in order. Why? To get us into a place of exchange. So you can constantly, listen, we live a life of exchange. Amen? We're exchanging our debts. We're exchanging our lack for abundance. We're exchanging our life for his life. There's a constant place of exchange. You're exchanging the worldly identities for your true identity. You're exchanging the labels that have been placed on you and strongholds for who you truly are, where Jesus says who you are, not what man says. See, there's a human standard that man looks at. We must not live by human standards or human precepts. We live by eternal precepts, not by man's precepts. And that's why when you get into that place of position, things are exchanged all the time. If you're still living according to human precepts, you are disconnected. And you're missing. And then you miss when God's trying to get something to you. Because the enemy comes to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. Maintaining removal of human viewpoints and discouragements, feelings and belief systems. All of these things are in a position at a place of exchange. But you got to be in divine order. There's an order to get there every single day. God sets things in order. He is the God of order. Amen? And I'm going to close at 2 Timothy 2. Things are about to explode. Remember, this is a year of exposure. Second Timothy 2:20. But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, in other words, he gets disconnected from the world, he will be a vessel of honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. Flee also youthful lust, but pursue what? Righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a what? Pure heart. Listen, you got to be careful who you associate with. Associations bring impartations. You hang around with enough vipers, you're going to get bit. And you're going to be acting like that. Good company corrupt. I mean, bad company what? Corrupts good habits. You need to be careful. You're going to be sanctified, set apart for the Lord. not walking according to the world. Listen, you can't approve what the world approves. If anything that God disapproves, you should be disapproving also. If not, you'll be judged away according to the world. If you approve same-sex marriage, abortion, and all the other acts of lust and perversion and addiction and all the other things, you'll be judged just like them. But I accepted Jesus. You're trying to explain that to Jesus when you stand before him, what you approved. You'll be judged the same way. Amen? That's why he says, depart from them. Come out from among them. Be separate. Verse 23. But avoid foolish and ignorant disputes, knowing that they generate strife. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all. Able to what? Teach. My goodness, the things that we learn, we should be able to teach. Oh, yes. Be able to teach. Do what? What's the next one? Patient. Patience is endurance. Endurance. Listen, you're going to be hard-pressed. Evil's getting worse. It's not getting better. You're going to be hard-pressed. You're going to be tempted in all sorts of areas. That's why you got to get in. You got to assemble. You got to maintain that place of position of exchange. You've got to maintain the fear of the Lord. Again, when that begins to compromise and slack off, you need to fall to your knees and cry out for help. Verse 25. Let's start at verse 24. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient, in humility, correcting those who are in opposition, if God perhaps will grant them repentance so that they may know the truth. And that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to what? Do his will. Wow. To do his will. God is making a way of escape. He always makes a way of escape for me and you. If we have an ear to hear and a heart to receive. If we have a what? Ear to hear and a heart to receive. Your two enemies are pride and fear, aren't they? Remember, the world is ruled by deception. It's ruled by fear. And what keeps people away from God is the perverse lust. Sin. Amen? Amen. Sin is the presence of evil. Again, we are in perilous times, but glorious times. Amen. What a time to be alive, to see all of these things happen. And come on, man, you're seeing the powers of darkness and the warring angels battling one another now. I mean, you can see it happening. But I'm telling you, God is kicking butt. You know, we know the end result. We won. But in the meantime, we got to continue the ministry that Jesus placed in us. We got to continue. We got to continue to drive out. It says that you and I are the ones that are restraining evil. So if you participate with evil, you ain't restraining it too much. Hello? We're the restrainers. Why? Until we're all taken out of here. Once we're all taken out of here, they're in the hands of God. But we'll be getting down. We're going to go up to get down. Amen? Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. I pray for each and every one here today, Lord, that a revelation, an impartation, that any scales or hardened heart would be removed, that any deafness or muteness or dumbness would be removed, that any area of rejection of your word would be removed, but there would be given counsel, correction, and direction so that order is placed in their temples, in their homes, in their lives, that they may reach the position of exchange and maintain the fear of the Lord. Lord, I pray this and ask this for each and every one in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody said amen.